shadows, a valance of velvet. Ideas are burning through our frontal bow like flames. Every human, a fire. But once there was nothing, until the dragon with the mane of sequin breathed fire, and the valens were no longer shaded in shadows, but scorched of flames, like solar systems. Flames drape the world, and the tides of time rushes in. Mural flames grew into solitary fires. But is every human a fire that can burn on its own? What is it to be human? Is it to recycle? Is it to be in here in the concert hall in Gothenburg? Is it to divide social class, place of birth, color, sex? In this performance, we, together with you, will explore the human nature. Because this is a story about us.
Echoing tonight, but she hears only whispers of some quiet conversation. She's coming in 12:30 flight. The moonlit wings reflect the stars that guide us towards salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words or ancient melody. He turned to me as if to say, "Hurry boy, it's waiting there for you."
equal opportunity for all to sing as they clap their hands. Just because the record has grown, don't make it any good.
Lite mer röst. Bam, bam, bam. Säg, hej, säg. Världen håller på att rasa. Brinner måla glasen, men jag vägrar ta tillbaka. Tiden rinner ut, det är dags för världen nu att vakna. Hur ska vi förenas när vi inte lyckas skapa? Vi måste våga få med oss hela staden, sluta klaga. Svara, varför skrappar ner på våran gata? Så jaga, alla som funderar, vi ska skapa. Hålla en gemensam, vi är galna. Vi ska skapa nya världen, alltid ska vi vara glada. Går upp för mig när solen går ner. Kan inte drömma mig bort. Jag ser problemen i mitt ögonlåg. För jag kan inte sova något mer. Allting går upp för mig när solen går ner. Kan inte drömma mig bort.
Okej, okay. För dem som alltid bara tvekar på mig, vägrade höra mina visioner för det. Öret valde mig, jag valde livet och vägen jag följde. Drömmen i sikte men ensamstående än idag. Alla mina vänner lekte bröder men ingen är kvar. Tänker på hur det kunde varit om jag valde fel. Världen som natten blir det problem, ingen hör och ser. Om du blir huggen i ryggen är det en vanlig lek. Klarade mig ganska bra, jag satt på ett hit och skrev.
Jag kan inte sova något mer. Allting går upp för mig när solen går ner. Jag kan inte drömma mig bort. Jag ser problemen.
Jag kan inte sova något mer. Allting går upp för mig när solen går ner. Kan inte drömma mig bort. Jag ser problemen i mitt ögonlåg. För jag kan inte sova något mer. Allting går upp för mig när solen går ner. Kan inte drömma mig bort. Nej, nej.
The nighttime city goes away to hide. Hear her voice, just an angel, sweet seducing smile. Why?
Tell them that it's human nature. Why?
it's human nature.
Why does it do me that way? They say why? Tell them that it's human nature. Why does it do me that way? I like living this way. I like living this way.
Of an extraordinary performance by the culture summer workers, Kultur sommarjobbarna. This is a very special project by the city of Gothenburg, where young people get employed by the city to perform within their own culture. And I have here Sophie Sydved. You have put together with your friends a special performance for the planet and people.
Yes.
Tell me just some sentence more about it.
We'll perform in the next week and the week after that until the 10th of July in the streets of Gothenburg. The show will be twice as long as the one you've seen. This afternoon we'll be at Götaplatsen, just outside this concert hall, and then we'll be at different sites at Gothenburg.
So thank you very much. An extra applause to the cultures. So I wish all of you welcome to WEEC 2015, the 8-week conference, and the first one ever in Northern Europe. My name is Katarina Gårdfeldt, and I will be your master of ceremony today. And I am also the director of the Center for Environment and Sustainability at University of Gothenburg and Chalmers University of Technology, who also hosts this event, this Congress. We have all at the center here in Gothenburg worked hard and long to organize the WEEC 2015, and I'm so happy to see you all here today. First, I have a very small practical information. In case of any emergency within the concert hall here, there will be instructions from the concert hall staff, and please follow their advice in such case. Okay, our next speaker here, our first speaker, will be the chair, one of the co-chair for the WEEC 2015 conference. And we will now listen to Ingrid Pramling Samuelsson. Ingrid, you are the co-chair of the WEEC 2015 and professor in early childhood education at University of Gothenburg. You also hold a UNESCO chair of early childhood education for sustainable development. So welcome.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Well, on behalf of Professor Arjen Valls and myself as a co-chairs for the 8th World Environment Education Conference, I want to wish you all welcome. We are very happy that so many participants have signed up for this important conference. Altogether, we are around 800 participants from 75 different countries. And we have many hundred presentations, of which make these 3 days of conferencing challenging in more ways than one. As individual participants, we may have problems to choose what to attend. But it may also be challenging in the discussion with the diverse perspective and standpoints. But that's what science is all about. At the same time, I hope we will be able, within the various themes, to locate and agree upon what the main challenges are in the question dealt with in the conference. So, why are we in Gothenburg, Sweden? Well, because we have a beautiful city and a beautiful archipelago that I hope you will have possibility to visit. We have one of Sweden's most diverse population, and I'm sure we have people from as many countries as here are in this room today. We have two of the country's largest and best universities in Sweden, Gothenburg University and Chalmers University of Technology. But not the least, we have the Center for Environment and Sustainability, who has been the hub for the whole conference. This conference is about education, environment education, which I suppose will be for all. Education for all has globally been on the agenda since it was initiated in Jomten in 1990 and returned in Dakar in 2000. The most important commitment to education in recent decades, and which has helped drive significant progress in education. To reaffirm the vision and political will reflected in numerous international and regional human rights treaties that stipulate the right to education and its interrelation with other human rights. But we are not there. All children do not participate in education, and some who does do not learn properly. 5 weeks ago, the World Education Forum was held in Incheon in the Republic of Korea, with the goal of ministers and key stakeholders to agree on the Sustainable Development Goals, one of which Target 4 is about education. And the goal says, ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all. And all means all. All ages, from early childhood education to adult education. And in all countries, south, north, east, west, in all local regions and municipalities, and for all boys and girls. Education is about access, inclusion and equity, gender equality, quality, and lifelong learning opportunities. At the World Education Forum conference, where the agenda for the Sustainable Development Goal in education was set, the slogan was, "Education transforms lives." That's why it's so important during the next few days to share all what we today know about learning and teaching related to the question of environment education in an extended way. Like the title of this conference points out, planet and people, how can they develop together? So once again, feel very welcome to three intensive and inspiring days of conferencing where we hope you will learn, share and create encounters with new people from various parts of the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Ingrid. I will now present the next speaker, Mario Salomone. Mario Salomone is the Secretary General of the WEEC Permanent Secretariat. He's an environmental sociologist teaching at University of Bergamo in Italy and the editor of the Italian monthly review, Eco, and the international scientific journal, Cultura della Sostenibilità. Also the president of the Italian Federation of Environmental Media. Please, Mario.
Thank you, Katarina. Good afternoon. The media is representative of international institutions, of the city of Gothenburg, a Chalmers universities. Dear friends and colleagues involved in environmental education, my warmest thanks for attending this 8th Congress in Gothenburg. Many thanks also to all people unable to attend the Congress for a lot of reasons, as scarcity of funds or personal problems, but interested in environmental education and in our congresses. Many thanks to the Gothenburg and Chalmers University, to the scientific and advisory committees, to the Center for Environment and Sustainability, to the staff of the local organizing committee and the permanent secretariat, and of course, to all bodies that are helping us. Your participation is going to give value to the meeting. All people will leave the Congress with a luggage rich in terms of new friendships, partnerships, contacts, suggestions, best practices, and I hope. All people will leave the Congress more open-minded and with an improved motivation and enthusiasm. Since 2003, this is the spirit and the main aim of the World Environmental Education Congresses. Since 2003, we reached the four continents, collecting thousands and thousands of people of different cultures, languages, religions. On Thursday, we will announce where the 9th Congress will be held in 2017, and from now, we encourage all of you to consider a candidacy for the 10th Congress in 2019. The call for bid opens today. Since 2013, we are also engaged in building in Europe a regional network and the pan-European area or consultation on environmental and sustainability education. So, I take the opportunity to invite all the European attendees to join the third Pan-European Days of Environmental Education that will be held on the 1st and the 2nd October in Barcelona, organized by Government of Catalonia. I thank you warmly, jointly with the Permanent Secretariat at the Network of Regions for Motors for Europe. I encourage all of you to get involved and contribute to the discussions. You can find more information on the special website of the event at the Network International website. Dear participants today, Congress in Gothenburg, we are proud for the capacity of our worldwide community to organize an international meeting each 2 years. We are proud to contribute to build awareness, capabilities, participation, and ecological citizenship. We are very happy for this intersection, a true crossroads of institutions, actors from civil society, scientific researchers, experiences, and competences, making the Congresses a friendly site where top-down and bottom-up initiatives, and where academia, public bodies, associations, companies can enhance dialogue and collaboration. But distinguished authorities, their friends, their colleagues, but we are not proud, we are not satisfied with the present sad world. In the present world, there are too many wars, too many walls, too many refugees and migrants, too many social injustice, too huge ecological debt, too much violence, too dangerous military expenditures. The humankind seems orphan of horizons, of solidarity, of dreams, of freedom, through democracy and participation. In too many countries, the humankind is hostage of egoism, xenophobia, fear, business as usual. This framework is closely linked with the robbery of the planet that continues unabated and indeed worsens. It is that I call syndrome of Phileas Fogg. From the novel of the French writer Jules Verne, Phileas Fogg burned all wood on his steamship for reaching the United Kingdom in time for winning the bet. As Phileas Fogg on the boat Henrietta, we are burning renewable and non-renewable resources for supporting an impossible and unsustainable socio-economic system. We are burning our future and the right for future generation to enjoy the great beauty of the Earth, its biodiversity, and to live safe and peaceful. In general, the atmosphere is not encouraging, as main focus is on the growth, but the cost of the growth is both for humankind and for the planet. In many countries, the economic crisis and public spending reduce the funding available on, for environmental education that is not considered essential. So, all actors engaged in environmental education over the world need the network to be strengthened. So we are opening a campaign of formal adhesion to the network so that to be able to disseminate information about your activities, to promote events and publication via website and newsletter, to enable collaboration and partnerships, to be better informed about what is happening in the world. Since we are working on the extension of the network, we will welcome any support, any direct engagement, both at the cultural and scientific level and on initiatives on the world network. I thank you for your attention, my warm wishes, and a happy and useful Congress.
Thank you, Mario. Thank you. Thank you, Mario. Now we welcome Pam Fredman. Pam Fredman is the Vice-chancellor for University of Gothenburg. She is also professor in neurochemistry with a degree in chemical engineering at Chalmers University of Technology. Please.
Thank you. So, welcome to Gothenburg. I will promise you, tomorrow the summer will arrive, so you will see something else of Gothenburg. It is a great honor that Gothenburg has got the privilege to host the 8th Congress addressing education for sustainable development. The universities of Gothenburg, Chalmers and University of Gothenburg, have a long tradition in research for sustainability, and also to include sustainability perspectives on educational programs. Initially, the focus was on environmental sustainability, but today, economic, social, cultural perspectives are included and developed. There are, of course, many factors behind our development, but I would like to highlight two of them. First, the leadership engagement is of utmost importance. And already 2001, the then rectors of Chalmers and University of Gothenburg mandated the Center for Environment and Sustainability, GMV, as a cooperation platform. This was an important and foresighted decision that promoted collaboration and networks between researchers and teachers in the two universities, but also with other universities. The establishment of the center also led to a visibility of our university's activities in the field to non-academic organizations, decision-making authorities, and politicians. To share and exchange knowledge is a role of the university. Second, the engagement of the students. The students have been strong driving forces to see that all perspectives of sustainability are integrated in all our courses and programs at our university. This activity is a positive and may be one of the most important signs for realizing a sustainable development. Our students, wherever they will work and act, are those who will be responsible for the future where planet and people go together. The world is facing demanding and escalating challenges. The future of humanity is challenged by climate changes and related environmental destructions, social and economic inequalities, cultural and religious conflicts. Every day we witness the terror and violence that affect societies in many parts of the world and may affect any society. Millions of men, women, and children trying to escape to find a hope for the future. It is obvious that a transition to more sustainable societies is needed. Solutions to these challenges require new thinking from not only economic, but also ecological, social, and cultural perspectives. How do we create an inclusive society where respect and trust between individuals, groups, to authorities are elemental? The society, politicians, business, and official sectors, household, individuals, everyone has a responsibility. Everyone has a responsibility for the sustainable development that will save the planet for the next coming generation. And once again, this includes ecological, economic, social, and cultural aspects, and all over the world. This will require commitments from society, politicians, business, and official sectors and individuals. Knowledge creation and transformation are essential. This requires that all people are given the opportunities to get on board, and for this, education is the key. People, individuals, has to be empowered to walk the talk. The university has a responsibility and key role to promote sustainable development. The role of universities and higher education institutions is to do research and provide education free from economic, ideological, or political dependence or pressure, according to Magna Carta 1988. In the introduction film to this Congress, the co-chair, Arje Waltz, mentioned the triple P's, planet, people, and profit, for a sustainable development. This will require that researchers and teachers from humanity, social science, performing and applied arts, medicine, technology, and natural science work together. New solutions need such multidisciplinary approaches, but also the interaction and dialogue with other actors, politicians, private and public sector. As I expressed before, education for all is a prerequisite for fulfilling sustainable development goals. Citizens, regardless of their geographical location, social, culture, or economic backgrounds, should have access to education of quality at all levels, from preschool to higher education. We also have to see too that individuals are provided a second chance in education and a lifelong learning. It is therefore urgent to promote and make visible education and higher education and research in the WEEC2015 agenda. This is a priority of the International Association of Universities, IAU, where I'm a vice president. The activity and standpoints of this organization largely reflects my own that are expressed in this introduction. IAU was founded in 1950 and is the UNESCO-based worldwide association of higher education institutions. It brings together institutions and organizations from some 120 countries for reflection and action on common concerns and collaborates with various international, regional, national bodies active in higher education. Through this worldwide network, knowledge and experience on how to promote higher education for sustainable development is shared. Unfortunately, political and economic agendas today do not always favor education for all. This, despite the awareness of what that a knowledge-based society is needed if there should be a sustainable future for the next generations. Not only is too much focus given to the third P, the profit, there is also a focus on west-east and not south-north, often excluding more than half of the world population south of the equator. Beyond the role of higher education institutions in teacher education, or in training of teacher trainers, it has a responsibility to provide and disseminate new knowledge in educational science. To meet the goal of education for all, the educational offer needs to reflect the diversity in background of learners and to better integrate increased digitalization. It needs to improve interaction between preschool, primary, secondary, and higher education subsectors. I know that a Congress like this is involving a lot of people, and it's a hard work for many. And I would take the opportunity to thank you all who has participating in making this a reality. And I'm not going to give a certain name, but I would like to special thanks to the co-chairs for this meeting, Ingrid Pramling, the chair of the National Scientific Committee, and Arjen Waltz, chair of the International Advisory Committee. This program will open up for multidisciplinary knowledge sharing, contacts, and networks, and I do wish you a successful Congress and welcome.
Thank you, Pam. Now we welcome John Holmberg. John Holmberg is the Vice President for Chalmers University of Technology and Professor of Physical Resource Theory. He holds a UNESCO chair in Education for Sustainability. No, for Sustainable Development. The role of universities in the transition towards sustainability is the name of your talk. Welcome, John.
Thank you. And on behalf of Chalmers University of Technology, I also want to welcome you warmly to this conference. And I will talk about the role of universities in this transition towards sustainability that also was mentioned by Pam. I will start from the Nagoya Declaration. The Nagoya Declaration summarized the decade for education for sustainable development. It also pointed the way forward. And you can read about the whole institutional approach, transformative knowledge production, promotion of innovation across sectoral and disciplinary boundaries, with emphasis on involving and respecting the youth as key stakeholders, with special attention paid to system-wide holistic approaches and multi-stakeholder cooperation and partnerships. And if you also look into the Sustainable Development Goals, the 17 that will be decided on in September and will work from January next year, I've been involved in many expert meetings this spring at the UN headquarters arranged by DESA, and what is the common conclusion from all the meetings are that you should not read this as a list. Everything is integrated. Everything is integrated. And that means that based on the Nagoya Declaration and also based on the SDG process, two keywords seems to arise. One is transformation. We cannot work as slow as we do now. We have to speed up, transform system. We have to change system. Business as usual is not good enough. Transformation. And the other is integration. We cannot work with one issue at a time. We don't have time for that, and it is sub-optimization. And we cannot work alone. We have to work together. So transformation, integration. And how can we deal with that as universities? The transformation has to be understood. The transformation for what we have now is almost the same magnitude as we went from agricultural society with low intensity, low efficiency, low material growth into the industrial society with high intensity, low efficiency, high material growth. And now we need high intensity to feed 10 billion people, but the efficiency, especially when it comes to material use, must increase tremendously. It is a take, make, and waste society that has to be transformed into something else. That means it is much lower material growth. And we can see in many areas that this transformation is happening. very much so in the energy system right now. So I would say the better we can explain and help the world to understand this transformation, the more relevant will we be for all stakeholders outside university. And when it comes to universities, I will talk about the whole institutional approach. And it has become, as Hela named it at the GUPES UNEP meeting yesterday, the Global University Partnership for Sustainable Development, she named it as the, it is a monoculture of mind. It has become more and more divided into different focus areas. And now it's time to build the world whole again. And when we talk about that, we have to realize that organizational structure is critical. It's critical to achieve this. And in my university, 7 years ago, we tried to implement something else. We tried to implement 8 challenge-driven, cross-cutting areas of collaboration within society and within university and with university and outside world. And those 8 areas of advance have the sustainable development as a driving force, everyone. And the leaders of those areas of advance are on the same level as the leaders of the department. So it is a matrix organization. And you have your employment at the department, but you can be active, collaborate on any of those or several of those areas of advance. And that has opened up for us to work better with this transformation and integration between ourselves and also with our outside world. So that has been very important. And in those area of advance, we try to integrate research, education, innovation within the area of advance. And therefore, they become a natural meeting places, an option for interaction. It's easier to find in and out from the university to deal with the challenges. And by that, we can collaborate with our triangle with public and private sector to identify challenges and opportunities and our different roles. We can act as a node in the region for knowledge production, try to develop test beds for future solutions in those knowledge clusters and attract competence into those. And in this region, we have worked with two universities together with the city and the region and the Chamber of Commerce to identify 5 areas where we want to test new ideas, to really meet the challenges regarding sustainable development. And that means that we have to change our behavior at the university from being like this, producing something out to society, more working together with society, to identify the question together with other stakeholders and produce results more frequently out from university. And when that is done, it is sometimes easy, often difficult. It is difficult because sometimes very simple factors can hinder this transformation. Simple factors, individual interests, actually. And that is frustrating to see and realize how much hinder it is in the system to make this happen. And one trick there is actually to put the student in the center. And that is an essential factor, because we have tried with the students to help them with identify the best tools to deal with complex societal challenges, to deal with industry, academy, and society, and trust them to do that. And when that is done, the students make real difference. We have experience on that. And the reason for that might be that students are really eager to change, but they are not threatening anyone. All doors are open for students. Nothing is written in the forehead on the student. And they are open to work and ask questions. And therefore, they also form a very important bridge between university and stakeholders in society. Because often we don't have the same rhythm in university and the stakeholders in society. But if you have a students in between, we can find a rhythm to work together. The experience from that, from Africa and from Sweden, here and many other places, as students are very important. So, when I will describe what has been important for when the change process actually has happened, I will use William Chalmers' motto, Avancer, to describe that. William Chalmers is the founder of our university. First, we need a vision. We need some clear commitment by the management team. Chalmers for a sustainable future. A clear why are we doing this? Intensive and structure. It has to be there. Then, and this is critical, we need to create platforms for collaboration, co-creation. A neutral arena organization with an overview and responsibility outside and across the traditional borders, an engine for issues that otherwise often becomes everyone's interest, but nobody's responsibility, an idea incubator, node for information. It has to be open and inviting. It has to be service-oriented, not building own empires, because then people do not want to join. It has to build trust and lower barriers, keeping the memory of the change process and give feedback to relevant stakeholders and thereby keeping up the change momentum. And this is not easy. But it is when this happens, change happens. Because then you can create space for people to be involved. And then the change process must build on the engagement, involvement of the individual. Therefore, the feature of the neutral arena organization must be adapted to meet those requirements, to invite people, not only to contribute to the answers, but also to formulate the questions, to create engagement by listening and learning rather than telling and teaching. And this makes sense because, as Peter Senge has written, the conscious act of creating space, of engaging people is genuine questions and often convening around a clear intention with no hidden agenda, creates a very different type of energy from that which arises from seeking to get people committed to your plan. So that is how you can bring the university on board. And if you have it, if you have the commitment from the management team, if you have this neutral platform, if you can create this energy from bottom up, then you can relax. Then it will be a self-playing piano. But only then. That is our experience. So the fundamental thing here is to create trust on those arenas. And trust is created by listening, observing, and understanding. Then you want to collaborate. It creates energy, creativity, and engagement. What is often happen is that you do not listen. You try to create your own, it in your own way. Misunderstanding, lack of trust, it creates social separation. Social separation means that the same thing is done in many places. When that is happening, the cost increase and resources decreases. And you feel internal competition within organization or between organization. And it creates fear. fear separate, and this will go on and go on in this direction. So the trick is to create trust by listening, listening, understanding, and listening. Another thing is that it seems if you want to bring people on board in this transition, it seems like what is can be a great barrier for what could be. So you have to leave today's situation and think about the future together. And that means that you have to stay in the question before you go to the solutions. You have to stay in the question and formulate maybe robust principle for what is necessary in that future. Then you can work together. And one very good example of robust principles to guide people into the future is this. Imagine what he did in India, and partly also in South Africa, with one guiding principle, equal rights. Imagine that if he instead start from today's situation with plans for the future, organization around those plans. Very clear, robust principle for what is necessary, guide transformation. Can we find those principles for this transition in different levels, for the different goals? Then we will be very much helped from that, I think. So by that, I also want to welcome you all once again and wish you a very fruitful conference. And also thank you, organizers, for making this happen. And if you want to read more about what I just said, you can download this book chapter free from a web page. So it's just to be downloaded. I don't know if you have this information somewhere. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, John. Thank you. Thank you, John. Now we will take part of a video message. Let me present Irina Bokova. She is the Director General for the UNESCO since 2009. As Director General of UNESCO, Irina Bokova is actively engaged in international efforts to advance quality education for all and enabling scientific cooperation for sustainable development, such as early warning systems for tsunamis and transboundary water management arrangements. Irina Bokova will deliver a video message to the delegates today.
Professor Pam Fredman, Vice-chancellor of the University of Gothenburg, Professor John Holmberg, Vice President of the Chalmers University of Technology, Professor Mario Salomone, Secretary General of the World Environmental Education Congress, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. I'm honored to address the 2015 World Environmental Education Congress. I recall well the 2013 World Environmental Education Congress in Marrakesh, Morocco, and I'm confident the 2015 Congress will help catalyze progress at a time when this has never been so important. Sustainability requires new ways of thinking and acting. Green economies are essential. More fundamentally, we need green societies and green citizens. This starts with education. With education that empowers, with education that develops new skills for global citizenship and sustainability. This is why education for sustainable development must stand at the heart of the new global agenda states are shaping to follow 2015. This was the message of the UNESCO World Conference on Education for Sustainable Development held in Japan last November. The same message was sent powerfully at UNESCO's World Education Forum last month in Incheon, Republic of Korea. UNESCO is leading the Global Action Program on Education for Sustainable Development to scale up action across the board. This is the importance of this World Environmental Education Congress, bringing all major actors and stakeholders to move forward together. I thank every participant for their commitment to the goals we share, and I look forward to a strengthened agenda for education, for sustainable development, and environmental education. This has never been so essential.
Thanks to Irina. Now we will take part of another video message delivered by Achim Steiner. And Achim Steiner is the Undersecretary General of the United Nations and the Executive Director of the United Nations Environment Program since 2006. In his career, he worked both at grassroots level as well as at the highest level of international policy making to address the interface between environmental sustainability, social equity, and economic development. Achim will deliver a video message to us.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the United Nations Environment Programme, I extend you my best wishes on the occasion of the World Environmental Education Congress in Gothenburg, Sweden. And I would like to congratulate the University of Gothenburg and the Chalmers University of Technology through their partnership in hosting this very important event. As many of you know, and as I try to also articulate at the Marrakesh Congress, UNEP's interest and commitment to environmental education remains as strong as ever. The challenge of trying to both empower, motivate, and inspire future generations, but also people across the planet on facing the challenges of environmental sustainability at this particular moment in time, but also to give them a sense of confidence to be able to make a difference, to be able to address these issues wherever they may live, whatever context they may be working in or living in, is vital to being able to succeed. As many of you may have heard, the notion of living in the age of the Anthropocene has become an idea that tries to both reflect the challenge and the nature and the scale of what we face today at the beginning of the 21st century, but also to locate our generations in a more historical perspective of the impact of human beings on the planet. In the last 200, 250 years, the impact that we have generated collectively by first of all becoming many more people on the planet, by becoming also more proficient and effective at harnessing the natural resources of this planet, but also through the footprint that we have caused through emissions, pollution, waste that we have produced, has led us to a point where a fundamental rethink is now called for. Living in the age of the Anthropocene is to recognize that the human species is no longer just one species on this planet, but it is increasingly one that is determining the functionality and indeed the viability of our fundamental life support systems, be it in the atmosphere, in the biosphere, or wherever we may be living and practicing and working, and indeed consuming and producing. We are very much aware of the fact that the year 2015 is a year in which the United Nations will be convening a number of very significant conferences and platforms for addressing precisely these challenges. One already lies behind us, Sendai, Japan, that looked at disasters and also our capacity in responding to the challenge of being confronted, first of all, by a greater frequency, very likely, and also extreme nature of natural disasters, and also by confronting the fact that we are many more people living in much more concentrated urban areas, and therefore having to face a much more significant fallout from these natural disasters. Secondly, will be a conference on financing for development in Addis Ababa in July, where a development partnership globally is being negotiated on how best we can mobilize resources, help one another across different parts of the world, and also mobilize, if you want, the financial economy of our nations and societies in order to align it better with the Sustainable Development Goals. In September in New York at the High-Level Summit, a new agenda post-2015 for development will be adopted, including a new set of Sustainable Development Goals. Their very central signal is that the United Nations is convening a global agenda that is going to be universal, applicable to all countries, all communities, all nations, And it is finally also taking another significant step towards overcoming what perhaps for the last 20 years has been a challenge, the segmentation, or if you want, the putting into different pillars of the economic, social, and environmental dimensions of development. Indeed, the integration of these three dimensions is going to be critical in both being able to scale up our efforts, but also to accelerate their implementation. Progress in economic terms at the expense of social equity or environmental sustainability has increasingly become the Achilles heel of development in the 21st century. The Sustainable Development Goals and their outlook in terms of how we will be able to address these challenges collectively but also individually is going to be a central part of interpreting that agenda into the future. Finally, in December, perhaps the most immediate and also most dramatic challenge will be addressed at the climate conference in Paris. The need to rethink, retool, and redesign our economies into a future pathway that allows us to move both towards low-carbon economies and, as the G7 summit recently acknowledged, into decarbonizing our economies before the end of this century is going to demand from all of us, whether national representatives, representatives of civil society and the business community, a envisioning of development that is fundamentally challenging and different from the past 200 years. The notion that we can continue to exploit nature, that we can emit and pollute without boundaries and without limits, simply is no longer holding. Many of you are very familiar with the indices and the indicators that lead us to believe that a business as usual scenario is a very dark scenario for the future of development, especially in a world that soon will have 9 billion people having to share, to live together, to consume energy, to produce food in a way that allows us to envisage a future for future generations. Indeed, the challenge of trying to decouple economic development from energy consumption, to make electricity consumption and production become a low-carbon opportunity rather than just a carbon-emitting challenge, but also the phenomenon of how on earth will we feed 8-9 billion people on this planet by 2050 are questions for which we may not yet have all the answers. It is in the core purpose of the United Nations to both bring the latest science to the attention of the public and also thereby contribute to a greater awareness and education both of the challenge, but, and this is my main message for today, of the opportunities to act. Environmental education is both an opportunity as well as a challenge of rethinking our approach. It is about empowering societies, and many of you are on the front line of experiencing how well people do respond to the power of knowledge, not only in the sense of science and learning about our planet, about our communities, but more importantly in triggering in our own minds, beginning with us as individuals, a sense of both responsibility and the capacity to act. Environmental education has been as a concept, as an objective and an aspiration with us for many decades, and particularly after 1992, the Rio Earth Summit, clearly an integral part of preparing ourselves for this challenge. At the same time, and many of you will be the first ones to acknowledge this, we have not yet managed to make environmental education part of the fabric of our educational system, but also of the knowledge economy of the 21st century. The ability to scale up these efforts, to reach the minds and also the hearts of people that will allow anyone, anywhere on this planet, to feel that they are part of making these solutions work is critical. We have in recent years particularly concentrated on the tertiary sector of education, and through the Global University Partnership, GUPES have now a network of over 520 universities with whom we are working together to try and make this environmental knowledge base part of the disciplines and also the professional training of virtually every discipline that allows us to enter the labor market. It is also through new means of communication, such as MOOCs, that we have been able to reach a far greater audience. And these are just two lessons and perhaps two assets that we can contribute to you, the community of environmental educationists who are so fundamental and so critical to the success of a future sustainable development strategy and a post-2015 development agenda. I look forward to both receiving the feedback from your meeting and the guidance of how we in the United Nations Environment Programme can continue to be and aspire to be also a more effective partner in achieving this scaling up of environmental education, both as a resource and also as a catalyst for future implementation of these agendas. I wish you a very successful Congress, and I know that in the city of Gothenburg you do indeed find a live example of a community having taken the challenge of sustainability to heart and putting in place many measures that are pointing to how we could envisage a city of the 21st century to be a role model for sustainable living. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Achim, for this video message, the opportunity to act, and the power of knowledge. We will now enjoy some traditional Swedish music and dance, folkdance, performed by the Gothenburg National Dance Sällskap.
thank you, Göteborg's National Danssällskap, for beautiful dance and music. We will now move on to the scientific part of the program, and I will leave the word to Stephen Sterling, who will moderate the first scientific session. Stephen Sterling is professor of sustainability education at Plymouth University, United Kingdom, and head of the Center for Sustainable Futures. Please.
Okay, it's about 1992. I was not in a conference, I was on a conference on a floating barge going through the Netherlands talking about environmental education. And I don't remember everybody there, of course, but one person who stuck out was a young guy with energy and fresh ideas. That guy was Arjen Vos. 23 years later, he's still got energy and ideas. Amazing. He's written over 200 articles and chapters. I don't know how he does it. It's kind of superhuman, really, I think. And what's irritating is I agree with almost all of it. I'm supposed to be, as an academic, critique other people's ideas, but Arjen's stuff is so good. And how he has such a prodigious output, I don't know. So if you were to ask me who's been maybe one of the outstanding thought leaders, and I think that term is deserved with Arjen, it would be Arjen. He's an outstanding communicator, writer, thinker, and I think he's made a terrific distance to this field over the last 20 years. As you know, he's co-chair of this conference. He's a professor of social learning and sustainable development. He's got a UNESCO share in this field and also professor of environmental education at Wageningen. It's pretty difficult for an Englishman. Wageningen. Thank you. One quick anecdote. Arjen and I were sharing a workshop at one of the highest parts of Norway 2 years ago. And at the end of the workshop, a number of people, and Arjen, I think, was probably the leader, plunged into this glacially cold glacial lake for a swim. And I thought he was kind of nuts, really. But I admired his toughness, really. And maybe you can see the metaphor coming up. Maybe we need more people who are slightly crazy going into hostile waters and making a splash, making a wave in this area. I want to finish with Arjen's own words. Ultimately, sustainability needs to emerge in the everyday fabric of life, in the minds of people and in the values they live by. Such emergence depends on how and what people learn, both individually and collectively. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Arjen Vos. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, what an introduction. I feel a little bit awkward almost. If I had my wooden shoes with me, I would do a Dutch wooden shoe dance. But I'm afraid we don't have a lot of time. In many ways, we don't have a lot of time. I will try to use about 20 minutes to in some ways, recap what has already been said, but maybe hopefully add some new things to it and connect with environmental education as a field that has been rather resilient, we might say. It has been around for quite some time, and it's wonderful to have a world congress in this field, and the fact that we're here with so many from so many countries shows that it's a very vital, vibrant field. Let's see. Go back to Sweden, a bit of history, 1972, that's well over 40 years ago. The Environment and Human Development Conference, shortly after the Club of Rome published its Limits to Growth report, in which many of the things that we are now recognizing are crucial and urgently needed in to be changed, were already in many ways mentioned. You could say it is somewhat frustrating that even though we had, not long after that, in 1977, one of the most significant international conferences in the field of environmental education in Tbilisi, Georgia, where UNESCO and UNEP together organized this international well-attended conference on environmental education, which, and if you read the declaration of Tbilisi, there are many things in that declaration that already talk about the importance of not just the ecological, but also questioning some of the economic systems at the time. It was quite a strong language in the declaration about questioning the economic models that were growing rapidly, which is one of the reasons that we titled the conference People and Planet, How Can They Develop Together, not People, Planet and Profit, How Can They Develop Together. Shortly, or not so much shortly after that, but if you go to 92, the Earth Summit, by then we were talking about, you know, we just had our common future, Gro Harlem Brundtland from neighboring Norway, and the World Commission on Development. Out of that, we had, of course, Agenda 21. We had a chapter on the role of education and communication, and the language shifted a bit, maybe from environment to sustainability. The seeds were planted, you could argue, for the decade of education for sustainable development. And then if we move not, you know, to more recent time, the Rio Plus 20, where you could say the world of business had come on board, which to some was a good sign, it becomes more mainstream, the discussions. To others, it was a sign of now we have to be cautious. We have to be very, we have to be very cautious, because what is that representing? Having the world of business joining, at least you could argue, it moved from the margins to the mainstream. The week we have to, you know, I can recognize the first week already in 2003. In Portugal, and now here we are in Sweden, 43 years after Stockholm. It's been mentioned, we have a finite Earth. We are in some ways overstepping our ecological boundaries, which is leading to all kinds of global systemic disruptions. We're no longer talking as much about toxic rivers or about acid rain or the hole in the ozone layer. We somehow have, in not everywhere, obviously in the world, but in many parts of the world, we have been able to somehow deal with those kinds of issues. But these global systemic problems that affect all of us, and some of us disproportionately, like climate change or loss of biodiversity, food and nutrition insecurity. They require that, and of course recognizing that we now have two times more people on the planet than we had back in 1972. So we have two times as many people using the Earth, you could say, exploiting maybe even the Earth. And we have, if you look just at food and health, we need to live much healthier in the years to come. Reduce our ecological footprints. We all know this in this room. And not only that, we don't have the resources available that we had in 1972. We could say we have been shrinking our resources. And if certainly if you look at biodiversity loss, it's quite dramatic. And it's not just a matter of producing more or being more efficient in it. We also need to think in terms of access, equitable use, fairness, things like that, very political issues as well. The Anthropocene has been mentioned as well. Recently, last week, in Science magazine, the news version of that magazine, one of the most, more prominent scientific magazines in the world, talked about the mass extinction that is going on. And indeed, it's the first time in history, you could say, that it is one single species that is actually influencing these large-scale geological, ecological systems in a very short period of time. The climate change, the IPCC report, we know that There has been controversy around it, the first one for sure. Now there seems to be more consensus, and even conservative forces in some parts of the world are beginning to recognize something is going on, something is happening, and it leading to a widespread concern, which could lead to a somewhat alarmist situation where the urgency and the kinds of disasters that are affecting people may lead us to take more eco-totalitarian options, where we forget capacity building, learning, education, and engaging people meaningfully in these profound questions. Irina Bokova mentioned, you know, the green economy and that it's very much needed that we green our economy, but we must also recognize that there are different perspectives on this, that this, not everybody sees the green economy as maybe something that will help them improve their livelihoods or their quality of lives. These are controversial issues. Green society, one of the sub-themes in our conference, how do we move beyond the green economy to the green society, maybe a better way of looking at this. There are people in some parts of the world that feel excluded by the green economy because they may not be able to participate in certification schemes or iPhone organic solutions or food systems and have it certified. These things are often expensive, and as a result, it is only to those companies that have the resources to engage and participate. So it could easily marginalize people if you don't think about that. So many of the issues that we are dealing with are highly contested and controversial. Organics is one example of that. And sometimes you could even argue that, for instance, climate change, where there is confusion among even scientists, even though there is this majority of scientists now recognizing something is going on, it's going to affect us and other species, and it is caused by what we do. There are those who have other views, also based on science, on their own research, and that even though it's a small percentage of the scientific community, they get maybe 90% of the media attention. So it leaves people confused, and much of the doubt that is created around, for instance, climate change, is even manufactured, some argue. Because if there is doubt, people will not be as likely to change or to act or to do something. And that is in the interest of those forces or economic interests that benefit, at least for the short time, from the status quo. And doubt is in some ways helpful to them. There are signs of hope. Whether this, you know, and people look for different signs of hope. Of course, some may see the Pope, Saint Francis, or Francis, who most of you will be aware, who spoke in a very elegant way of our role as humans on this planet to protect and to conserve our resources, but also is raising lots of issues around poverty. In the Netherlands, just last week, a Dutch court, in fact, declared that the Dutch government has been negligent in reducing CO2 emissions and in transitioning to renewables, which is a big success for what we call in Holland the Urgenda, which is a combination of urgency and agenda, a group of activist scientists, you could say, along with civil society organizations that filed a lawsuit against the government, and they actually won, which puts the Dutch government in a somewhat awkward position, but they will have to respond to this. Similarly, we had in the Netherlands recently 40 youth organizations petitioning the Dutch parliament to pay more attention to sustainability in education, which the parliament accepted. And now the Dutch government has to think about how do we respond from early childhood education all the way up to higher education and community-based education. So there are some things happening. At the same time, we have to recognize that there is a lot of information out there that people tend to use their digital technologies that are available all over the world to look for quick answers. And as educators, we need to think maybe not so much about linking people to information, but asking the more profound, deeper questions that make people think more deeply about these issues. As E.O. Wilson, I always like to quote E.O. Wilson, who says, "We are drowning in information while starving for wisdom." And that's a challenge for educators. How do we make people and ourselves wiser in the everyday decisions and actions that we take? Part of the problem, of course, is that we talk about complex and wicked issues for which there are no easy answers. And the answer, what we might think is sustainable today, may turn out to be unsustainable tomorrow. And what might be sustainable here in Gothenburg may be unsustainable in Kampala, Uganda, or anywhere else in the world. These solutions need to be found locally in a context, but at the same time, we must connect these localities with one another so we can learn at a higher level from each other, which is one of the reasons that we are gathering in an international context at a conference like this one. So we live in a way in strange, unusual times that call for a, and John Holmberg already mentioned it, a transition. In the 43 years, we have not really found a way to address issues that are characterized by high levels of uncertainty, ambiguity, indeterminacy. They are emergent. We need to constantly learn about them to keep up with the changes. But at the same time, they're very political. They have to do with values, with ethics. What are we strengthening in our schools, in our universities? What are we weakening? Whose voices are being silenced by what we do? It has to do with power. The drive to consume in our society is infinitely greater than the drive to sustain, if you will. And maybe it's not just about sustaining. There are many systems that are inherently unsustainable that we keep sustaining. They're resilient, and maybe we should also sometimes unsustain. I'll get back to that in a minute. I like to use this simple graph to show the different kinds of options that we have in responding to these big challenges. You could say on the one side there are those who tend to look in technological solutions, oftentimes engineering universities tend to do that. Or they get better at linking it with the societal components, of course. And there are those who look more in societal solutions. And if you look at that, you could say, well, some of these changes are incremental. We try to optimize the systems that we have created. There's nothing wrong with the way we organize our schools and universities or our economy. We just need to perfect them. We need to optimize them. We need to become more efficient. But the system itself, nothing wrong with it. We need to green it, and then we'll be fine. Or, which is more the transition perspective, we need to rethink the values that we are strengthening. We need to, the assumptions on which we base our economy. Maybe we need to question this drive to always want to develop, to always need to grow. Maybe the problem is growth. Maybe the problem is development itself. Maybe sustainability should be an alternative to development. Now, these are, then we're talking about rethinking and maybe even rethinking our ontologies, the way we are in the world. And that is, I ask also for a transition in what constitutes science, what constitutes learning and teaching. So you could say the transition perspective is not so much about doing the things we do better, but doing better things altogether. And that's a very different question. Now, if you make it a little bit more practical and you look at, for instance, food and foods and nutrition security, you could say if you look more at the optimization side of things, you could look at maybe increasing food literacy, or you could think about reducing food waste. You know, nothing wrong with our food chains, we just need to make them optimal, not throwing waste, consumer waste, reducing post-harvest losses, things like that. Or you could look at more technological solutions that are transitionary, like genetically modified food. Some argue if you need to feed 9 billion people in 2050, then we must have genetically modified foods, otherwise we'll never succeed. Or the blue revolution, like we had the green revolution on the land, now the oceans, we need to use the oceans far better to provide protein and food. Or you could say, well, no, they're more at the social side where we need to optimize things. You could say, we need food justice. It's all about more equitable sharing. Fairness. It's about maybe converting to insect proteins. We should start eating insects and not meat. That would help. That requires a rather cultural shift. Or, and this would be the more transition-oriented approach, maybe it's about thinking about closing cycles, cradle to cradle, or metropolitan agriculture. This graph you've seen before, I'd like to show it in a slightly different perspective. How do you move from, say, a small niche where people may start something new, a disruptive act or something, to change routines and systems and to start stirring it up a bit, being a little bit disobedient even. A lot of these changes, they start with some disruption, and not with an adaptation, but with a disruption, where niches of change coagulate to become a shift in a regime, or at the level of a regime, where they start strengthening one another to eventually a whole new landscape. Which may look at good start locally in early childhood centers with revisioning how children connect with green spaces. It could be something like guerrilla gardening, if you look at food, as again, where eventually that may lead to community gardening in cities or metropolitan agriculture, where the whole system starts shifting. And there are examples of a whole landscape where it's not just about food anymore, it's about well-being, it's about quality of communities, it's about social cohesion, it's about the nexus, energy, water, food, all coming together in a holistic, integrated way that John was speaking about as well. Of course, there are all kinds of, if you study this and start researching this, you could look at all kinds of indicators that may suggest that we are shifting from that niche to a whole system change, varying from the number of people involved, the diversity of groups involved, the social cohesion that is being built between people, and so on. Diversity, I think, is a key word. Social learning has been mentioned. When people have trust, another word that has been mentioned, then they listen better, they're willing to put themselves in the minds of others, empathy is built, and when you have that, diversity can become a powerful source of creativity. If that trust isn't there, then it could do the opposite. People would actually start opposing one another, and the whole learning process would be hampered by that. This picture, some of you have seen this before, it just doesn't need a lot of words. A lot of what we have here, the technology, the PowerPoints, the way we traveled here, is a result of a particular way of doing science and research that is of a reductionist kind, has been very powerful, but the problems it has created require a different way of looking at the world, a holistic one. Not just scientific knowledge is needed for that, but also indigenous knowledge, local knowledge, experiential knowledge, and so on. Some of the talks during this week will also talk about connecting the big five, we say. The world of education, the world of research, the world of civil society, the world of government, and the private sector. How can we co-create sustainability? And what is the role of environmental educators in mediating that, in brokering that, in facilitating that? And how can you create learning spaces where these groups come together in a good way? That's an important question. And indeed, just to emphasize again, the disruptive aspect, not just adaptive capacity, but also disruptive capacity, asking questions that allow us to interrogate, critique our everyday routines that are so normal, but they're highly unsustainable. At Wageningen University, but also at Gothenburg University, at the Department of Education or the Pedagogical Studies, Curriculum Studies, where I'm also working part of the time, we also look at understanding the kind of learning trajectories that allow people to move from these niches towards these whole system changes in their culture, in their organization. This is an example that I did with a PhD, some study with a PhD from Wageningen, Jifke Sol, where we look at what constitutes learning for transitions and what are tipping points in that show progress, and what is resilience, what does that mean? That if you move to a next stage from, say, a niche, a small brewing, a new idea where people get more interested, it gets more traction, it gets more policy support, how does that work? What are the kinds of levers, what are the kinds of barriers to conditions that allow for this type of learning to emerge? Okay, I'm going to wrap up. This figure you will remember from 8 slides back. If we look at this again from an education point of view, the incremental changes, we might look at digiboards or curriculum greening, where we do not really change our philosophy, our assumptions underneath teaching, but we use new technologies to optimize it. And that could be highly technologically driven. MOOCs are maybe an example of that, or the flipped classroom. Or you could look at the more societal, sociological, cultural perspectives, looking at new pedagogies, pedagogies of place, pedagogies of engagement, pedagogies of hope, critical pedagogies. There are all kinds of pedagogies that are more appropriate for learning for transitions than some of the others. And if you look at this transitionary perspective, then we talk about things like learning ecologies or whole institution approaches. Stephen Sterling, who just kindly introduced me, has often referred to the different responses that you might find in education to challenges of sustainability, from denial to maybe building it in incrementally, adding it on, and then building it in or integrating it, and ultimately maybe a whole system redesign, which is of course the most difficult one. In a very concrete way, I always like this to use this from a European Union project we were involved in years ago, but it still, I think, illustrates quite well this whole institution, whole system approach, where it is about democracy, about group learning, it is about connecting with place, it is about food security, localizing food security, allowing young people, children to connect with place, with neighborhood, bringing in local businesses to help maybe with the garden or the landscaping, connecting the community with the school, and in doing so, creating this vital coalition for sustainability. And we may call this ecologies of learning, like George Siemens talks about ecologies of learning, where we need to understand the filters, the worldviews, the assumptions that we bring to the table, where we also look not just at learning for something as, you know, to know, or something just to act, but also learning to be and learning to make change. Agency, empowerment, showing that you can make a difference when you organize things differently, but also when you can change the structures in which your school or community operates. I noticed that there are very many Spanish speaking people at this conference. I'm fortunate that Marta Chavez, my Colombian PhD student, who is also here, and then she'll have a wonderful talk. I'm plugging her now at 4 o'clock, but that's a different story. She has done a nice job translating that slide into Spanish, so that's just a little extra. Okay, my final key points. First, I think it's important that we need to get better in designing, investigating learning contexts and spaces that enable people, young and old, to develop embedded, sustained abilities. We need to think about what are these abilities? What are the abilities, capacities, competencies that help us become more sustainable? And that may also include unsustain, to disrupt, to unsustain, to start questioning, to start with little, sometimes, actions, disruptive actions that can lead to big changes. Think of Hawkins' Blessed Unrest book, where he talks about this. Secondly, we need to start blurring the boundaries between institutional, community-based, workplace learning, and start thinking more about learning as something that happens all the time, also including social media and e-supported learning. How can we connect those in better ways? Connected forms of learning, where we learn from experience, where the schools are places where we can reflect, but that's true for workplaces and the home environment as well. Critical thinking, key. I've said it many times. Start questioning the normal, the routines, the things that we are somehow captured by, that somehow disable us to see the inequality, to see the consequences of what we do elsewhere in the world, to see those connections and interdependencies. That requires critical thinking. And finally, what's really been missing maybe in the decade of ESD, I think, is the normative aspect. The ethics, the values, the working also with communities, indigenous communities, local communities that have a different way of relating to each other and to the world and to nature and seeing ourselves as part of nature. Those kinds of conversations, they haven't really occurred much. And maybe we could discuss this. But that normative dimension is crucial if we want to develop capacities that do not just strengthen growth, strengthen the economy, and help us become more competitive, but rather help us to become more in harmony with who we are, with each other, and with the planet. So, let me again, well, thank you for being here and coming all the way to Gothenburg. I'm really looking forward to the next few days, and indeed it will become sunnier. So let us learn to gather, enjoy together, but also to disrupt together and to act together and start walking the talk. And I give the floor back to Stephen. Thank you.
Here, you might be answering a question. Okay, I've just been asked to thank Arjen for his really rich talk, as expected, intellectually challenging. I always think if you want to change anything, you need three elements. You need critique, and you need a vision, and you need design. You need some idea of how to make the journey. And I think Arjen reflected those ideas very richly across all his slides. And even one of his slides, I think, could have been the subject of half an hour's talk. So thanks, Arjen. Great talk. We've just got a few minutes only, and I think there's a roving mic. So if you've got a concise question for Arjen, we'd be pleased to take it. Yes, this lady here. Okay.
Hi, Stephen and Arjen. My name is June Gorman. That was a fantastic talk and a fantastic intro to the very thing that I've been working hardest on myself with transformative education. My question is specific to your tipping points, and the one that threw me was the very first one on the chart, and maybe I just didn't understand, that it said commitment from the management. Now, to me, that's really the stopping. If that's the first tipping point.
Well, in this particular case, where Jifke studied daycare centers in the Netherlands, where a small group usually, and usually it was people, either parents or it was one of the people facilitating the children's learning in the daycare center, felt a need to make the daycare centers more connected with the natural environment, removing the concrete and putting in green spaces where children can explore and discover freely. And they often, in these cases, they would often run into the management as posing questions and critiquing it or saying it wouldn't be hygienic or it would not be safe or it would be too much risk and at some point, so they had to think, okay, how do we get the management on board? How do we involve people in the conversation so that they too see the benefit of transforming this environment into a more healthier place, really. And for them, the first tipping point was when the management started saying, yes, actually, this has merit, this is important, and this is actually going to improve the quality of our daycare. And that, for them, was a tipping point. But it will be different in other places. It may be the management driving it or starting it, and that problem is the reverse. How do we get the parents interested, or how do we get... So in this particular case, this is just an example of one particular case.
Well, on the small scale, that answers the question. On the large scale, I feel that it's the biggest barrier to moving on the large scale.
Okay. Yeah, could be.
Okay.
There, I see waving.
Can this gentleman here, is that okay? He's been waving his, yeah, thank you.
I see many hands.
You don't know how much time we have. Okay.
It's interesting how they darken the room.
Thank you very much, Professor, for a wonderful and captivating presentation. You made mention of something we should establish or develop something that is culturally relevant and locally acceptable, or locally relevant and culturally acceptable. But in so many ways, I think the international community forget that there are local communities in Africa that don't have knowledge of what is happening outside the world. And same individuals, same people, I've been left behind. In what aspect do you think universities like Chalmers University and United Nations, UNESCO and other UN bodies who come together and put in place some sort of shock absorbing mechanisms to help these local communities? Thank you.
Yeah, that's a good question. Of course, that no matter where you are, I think you will always find people who do not know what's going on elsewhere in the world. That's all. I know plenty of places in this part of the world where that's also the case. However, your point of people who feel left out and they do not feel, you know, they don't have an opportunity because they don't have the socio-economic position maybe, or they cannot participate in higher education, vocational education may be missing completely. I think it's if you turn the question to higher education, like a place like Chalmers or Wageningen or Gothenburg, I think it's really important to think more. Stephen started by saying that, you know, all these things that we have published as academics, and I think part of the problem is that we always write and that we do not really engage in community work enough. And I think our success as academics is measured by our output, our production almost, of scientific papers that, frankly, hardly anybody reads. Everybody's writing, nobody has time to read, everybody's writing for nobody. That is a big problem, and that's being changed, though. I think I see more and more universities recognize it should be science, not for impact factors, but science for societal impact. That means working with communities. That means that science is not the only way of creating knowledge. Like I said, there's lots of local knowledge. A lot of people without education have found lots of ways to live lightly on the earth, not so much by choice, but because they're forced to. They are, as David Orr says, the people with the biggest ecological footprints are the ones with bachelor's degrees, master's degrees, and PhDs, not the people growing up in poverty who didn't get formal education, but they learned an awful lot just because they had to survive, and their ecological footprints are much smaller than ours. So I think there are many answers to this, but it's a very good question, and I think hopefully one that will be raised in the strand on reducing poverty at this conference.
Okay, I've just got science. It's time for a little question and a little answer. So there's one in the box over there. Yeah. Sorry, we're just running out of time, but it's a shame.
Thank you, Professor, for such an inspiring and very deep presentation. I want to ask, where do you place on your reflection on listening and dialoguing, where do you place the South, North, North, South dialogue and partnerships and cooperation, as we could definitely share much concerning going beyond sustainable development towards sustainability?
I think there, you know, if you look at I think in the South there, you know, just the South, I find it a little bit difficult to talk about the South, but there are many communities in the world where dialoguing is more of an integral part of the way they govern, and there's governance at the local informal level that is much more already of this hybrid nature that I'm talking about here, as something that we should be, as something we need to strive towards. But in some ways, we also can go back towards it, because there are many places in the world where this type of, it's almost a natural synthesis between intergenerational learning, between learning from nature, with nature, in nature. That's already happening in many communities, and it's being lost. And in some ways, we're losing, as a humanity, as humankind, we're losing that ability that is there. There are many groups in the world that have survived, and more than survived, have thrived using this particular way of hybrid, blended learning that I'm talking about as something for the future, and that is something that is happening in pockets here and there. But I think we here in the North, let's say then, we could learn by listening, and that's why, again, these meetings are so important, that we come to understand those ways of being, those ontologies that are maybe healthier ultimately for the future of the planet than some of the colonial ones that we have been exporting.
Okay, thanks, Arjen. I think we have to stop there, is that right? Do we have to stop there? Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you both. Before we end the session, I will give you some practical information. We have a program full of exciting activities ahead of us, and when registering, you have all received a printed program in your conference bags. If you are interested in getting an overview of all sessions following a specific theme, or getting an idea about what will be discussed in different sessions, you can use the printed program received when the Congress, in the Congress bag, which provides you with the session names, program number, date, time, and place. If you are interested in knowing the authors or knowing the more detailed content of an abstract, you can use the program number, title, author, name, etc.
to search in the search database for the website WEEC2015, which also allow you to see the presentation place and time. All abstract presenters have received a presentation number and order in the abstract confirmation. Please be aware of the presentation order. The Wi-Fi codes can be found in the printed program as well. If you don't have a laptop or a smartphone, it is possible to borrow such a computer and read the more detailed program in the concert hall or in room D212 in the Humanisten building. Apart from the plenary sessions and the parallel sessions, we have a range of evening events, side events, and excursions. In order to not miss them, go to the website and read more and sign up, or ask for more information in the information desk in the concert building. Please wear the Congress badge visible at all times and also to all evening events. And for environmental reasons, we keep writing pads in the registration desk for people who need it to pick it up rather than putting it into the bags. Please be aware of your belongings all the time. Personal belongings can be left in the cloakroom at the concert hall, which is open every day, or in the cloakroom in room C361 at the Humanisten, which is open the first and the last day. Lunch and coffee will be served in the concert hall building in the exhibition area. And finally, I would like to get your attention on these bottles. Only clean tap water is served here. And we are proud to serve the Gothenburg healthy and sustainable tap water with no transport except in the tubes and no waste. So WEEC 2015 is a tap water certified event, and you can refill your bottles at any tap you see here in this building or out in the Götaplatsen outside. So finally, thank you all for being here and taking part of this inspiring start of the WEEC 2015. We are so excited to get this Congress started. And now coffee will be served in the exhibition area. And at 4 o'clock, we will start with parallel sessions in Humanisten and Hovrätten. So see you later. We'll be right back.